Welcome to part 11 of the New South and the Wild West. Now we're going to look at the second part of our series on the final Indian War. 2 years after the Sand Creek Massacre, the Cheyenne and the Arapaho will get some retribution at a place called Fort Phil Kearny in Wyoming. Them, along with some Lakota Sioux, on December 21st, 1866, will attack a group of Union soldiers there led by Captain William J. Fetterman, and they'll kill 81 men in what becomes known as the Fetterman Massacre. These men will be killed and they will be mutilated, quote, Sand Creek style. In other words, a lot of the things that happened there at Sand Creek will be done to these soldiers here Fort Phil Kearny. Okay. Now, at the time, this was the worst military disaster for the U.S. Army in these Indian Wars, but this is not going to be the worst overall. Later on, George Armstrong Custer is effectively going to say, here, hold my beer, I can beat that, right? What leads to Custer's ultimately rise and fall is the discovery of gold. In 1874, in the Black Hills in Dakota Territory, on the Great Sioux Reservation, gold was discovered. Now, as I mentioned before, the Sioux people were not indigenous to the Dakotas. They were actually indigenous to Minnesota, but had been pushed westward by white settlement, right? And so now they're in the Dakota Reservation, and they'd seen the Black Hills region as clearly sacred ground, these old rounded buttes, right? Clearly was holy land, right? So when gold was discovered there, all of a sudden, you've got 15,000 miners descending upon the area, much like what you had in Colorado and California on a lesser scale, but still nonetheless. But they're descending upon this seen as sacred ground to the Lakota Sioux. Now, the federal government under Ulysses S. Grant had actually offered to purchase the Black Hills from the Lakota for $6 million, but they'd refused that. Again, it's holy ground. They're not going to sell this, right? So finally, the solution to the problem for the federal government in December of 1875 was to redraw the boundaries of the Great Sioux Reservation, and of course, in redrawing the boundaries, excluded the Black Hills, and put out an ultimatum to the Native Americans, said, hey, look, you have got until January 1st, 1876, you need to get out of that region. If you're not out of that region by then, the U.S. Army is going to go in there and remove you from that region, okay? So they are a group of Native Americans that are going to be led by Principal Chief Sitting Bull, who are going to decide to stay there. So in January, you're going to have the U.S. Army and the 7th Cavalry Division move into the region to begin the process of getting ready to remove these now considered hostile Native Americans in the Black Hills. The 7th Cavalry Division was led by a man named George Armstrong Custer. Now, George Armstrong Custer is a pretty polarizing figure historically, right? He went to West Point, where he graduated last in his class. Well, at least he did graduate, right? During the Civil War, he rose very quickly through the ranks, achieving the rank of temporary general, who was one of the youngest generals at that time. He's only in his mid-20s. When the Civil War ended, he was actually reduced back to his permanent rank of colonel, but he refused to recognize the demotion and continued to wear his general rank, even though that's a clear violation of Army regulations. But he was well known for violating Army regulations. He wore his hair really long, golden, curly locks that would drape down over his shoulders. And when the Civil War ended, he had positioned himself to move out west and become an Indian fighter because he had political aspirations. He wanted to be president someday. We like to elect our war heroes president. And so he had a special Western uniform designed. It was suede with fringes on the cuff, like you see the U.S. Army wearing today, right? Okay. So he goes out there leading the 7th Cavalry Division. On the 22nd of June, 1876, he takes 600 men of the 7th Cavalry Division, and he leaves Fort Abraham Lincoln on a horse called Comanche and began scouting up the Rosebud River and heading towards the Little Bighorn River. Okay. Now, his designs are to take on Principal Chief Sitting Bull and another one of the men remaining on the Black Hills area, another chief named Crazy Horse, right, and remove them from the area. Now, he thinks he has the Lakota Sioux outnumbered, right? He's got his 600 men. He thinks there's plenty. His own men said, shouldn't we bring our cannons with us? And he said, nah, we don't need no stinking cannons, right? We're going to be able to rout these guys pretty quick. What he doesn't realize is that there are 6,000 Lakota Indians there in the Black Hills, of which about 2,000 of them are warriors. He's actually heavily outnumbered, and they're also planning to spring a trap. Custer makes things even worse. He takes his small force of 600 on June 25th, and he splits them up with the idea of encircling the Lakota there at Little Bighorn. He's thinking his numbers are superior. And in the process of doing that, he actually strung his forces out. So they're not only split, but they were strung out. And so his group actually got ambushed by Crazy Horse and his men. And it was a slaughter. 268 men of the 7th Cavalry Division were killed, including George Armstrong Custer. Matter of fact, historians today now like to debate on how he possibly died, because when his body was recovered later, it was found with two gunshot wounds, one in the chest and one in his left temple, right? And so some argue that perhaps that second wound, the one in the temple, was self-inflicted. They didn't do any forensics, right? We don't have the bullet, right? We can't analyze it today, okay? Both Crazy Horse and Sitting Bull would escape, at least for the time being, right? But this battle was a disaster, this battle of June 25th and June 26th. And one of the reasons why is because news is going to filter to the East Coast about a week later. Well, if you're looking at a calendar, you might see that that's significant, right? A week later, that's around the 4th of July. Actually, July 2nd is the first time that news breaks in New York City on this now called massacre, in which the 7th Cavalry was completely wiped out. I mean, it's an exaggeration that was put out there that has persisted even to the modern day, right? But it's not just the 4th of July. It's an important 4th of July. It's 1876. It's the centennial. So here we have the Americans on the East Coast getting ready to celebrate 100 years of America, and then they're bombarded with these headlines. 7th Cavalry Division massacred, wiped out by brutal, bloodthirsty Sioux Native Americans, right? It does create a sense of bloodlust that we're going to see in these final battles here in the last decades of the Indian Wars. And 4 years later, by 1880, pretty much all the Plains Indians had been relegated to reservations in either the Dakota Territory or in Oklahoma, mostly in Oklahoma, right? And life on these reservations were pretty awful, right? The land is not really good for farming, and they had to rely very heavily on government rations for food. And these rations were intermittent. If there was any kind of financial upset in the American economy, these rations were usually the first thing to be cut off, right? In the 1880s, disease began killing Native American livestock, and the Native Americans on these reservations were literally starving to death. And the result of this was that despair often leads to people turning to faith. This is true no matter what culture you're looking at. And so you start to see a religious movement grow in the 1880s in the Oklahoma reservations. This movement is known as the Ghost Dance Movement. It was started by a self-styled Indian prophet, a Paiute Indian by the name of Wovoka, right? Now, Wovoka in 1889, during a solar eclipse, believed he had had a vision of the second coming of Christ, that Christ was coming, and so was the apocalypse, and it was coming to destroy the white man. And that if the Native Americans didn't want to be part of this cleansing, they needed to purge themselves of the evil of the white man. And they had to do that by calling upon their ancestrals to help them cleanse themselves through ceremonial dance and meditation. From this comes the ghost dance, right? So Wovoka begins this ghost dance movement, right? Now, the ghost dance itself is very provocative, right? It's very aggressive. And if you're just a white settler, doesn't really understand what's going on, it looks very warlike. You're like, uh-oh, these guys are ramping up to begin another series of attacks on white settlers in this area, right? Well, in 1889, Lakota sent a delegation to meet Wovoka, and the ghost dance went up to the Great Sioux Reservation, right? When the Great Sioux Reservation adopted the ghost dance movement and began doing the ghost dance, the settlers up there became really, really concerned. Remember, we got some history here, right? We have things like the Sante Sioux Uprising. We have the Kettleman Massacre. We have the Battle of Little Bighorn, which is still pretty fresh on people's minds. And now it looks like that the that the Lakota are ramping up for a fight again, right? So they become really concerned, and so they petition the government to do something about this. Well, the United States military in 1890 decided that the solution was to arrest Sitting Bull. He is clearly the primary instigator. We arrest him, and his followers will disperse, and we'll be able to take care of it. Okay. So on December 15th, 1890, an attempt was made to arrest Sitting Bull. However, during this interchange, a melee broke out in which shots were fired, in which a bullet struck Sitting Bull and killed him. Once that happened, the followers of Sitting Bull went on the run, and the United States military immediately went in pursuit. The military unit that pursued them, the 7th Cavalry Division, that same division that had been bloodied by the Lakota Sioux back there in 1876. And again, like I said, there's a little bit of bloodlust going on here. They will round and surround the Lakota Sioux that were running near at a place called Wounded Knee on December 29th, 1890. And initially they'd begun negotiations for a peaceful settlement, but at some point somebody fired a shot. And once that happened, the 7th Cavalry proceeded to pour in machine gun fire, well, rotary cannon fire, and artillery fire into the Native Americans there. They killed up to 300 of them in the process of doing this. Men, women, children, you name it. There were so many dead on the field there that they actually couldn't bury them. The ground was frozen. They had to wait till the spring and then dig mass graves. That's what the picture you're seeing here is of mass graves to bury the number of dead. Now, the battle here at Wounded Knee is the last of the major conflicts between Native Americans and the United States Army. Though, to be fair, there are still going to be minor skirmishes that are going to continue on all the way into the 1900s. For example, the Apache Indians will be one of the last groups that will be subjugated, will continue raiding towns in the United States and Mexico as late as 1924, and the Apache will not be completely subjugated until 1933, right? But pretty much after Wounded Knee, this is the last of the true conflicts between the federal government and the Native Americans.